Is that a bayonet?
Yeah.
For a rifle?
Yeah, Alabama slammer.
Yeah, I see the hole where the barrel goes out.
From the middle? This is the first horizon. First horizon. Right off the top. Well, on our first. Yeah.
Okay, Austin, I'm going to get you texturing on camera.
I have lots of pictures of me texturing.
My phone actually is
good. You want me to hold the...
You can start coloring if somebody wants to break out that book.
Yeah, I'll do that.
Looks like 3-1.
3-1?
Yeah, right here.
Talk about how deep do I need to describe in detail. And it's an unknown amount. The first thing that you do want to do is get a good general idea of what is underneath you. In other words, what are the resources here? And most of you guys hit a sandy layer down there where you had water in it, free water. So that means you're underneath the water table at that point. Okay, and some of you got some very beautiful, look at those, look at the oxidized iron at the top of that water table, and then look at this glade color down underneath. And this is what Lee was saying earlier he wanted you guys to see. Yes, I'm being careful, yes, but yes, I will hurt myself before the end of this trip. It always happens. Whenever you've got colors like this, you're very likely for this to fit onto the glade page. It's so much grayer than anything that you see up here. In fact, it looks green when you compare it to this other. It was green. All right, Matt, is it the same color it used to be? Okay, there you go. How many people in class wanted to know what a reduced matrix would look like? You just looked at one. The color that you read when you immediately dug it out, you found it underneath the water table. That's not a strict requirement, but that's a common sense requirement. If something's exposed to oxygen, it's already changed colors. So if you're looking for something that changes colors upon exposure to oxygen, then you're going to want to get it from underneath a water table where there may not be any oxygen. All right, and you read the color, and if it's on the glade page and a value of 4 or more, not a dark color on the glade page, that's why it's important to know whether your value is 3 or less or 4 or more. But if it's 4 or more on the glade page, and then you read the color 15 minutes later, and it's even one chip higher in value or higher in chroma, or if it no longer fits on the glade page, you have a reduced matrix. If it stays on the glade page, you have a glade matrix. Okay, so that's two of the three matrices that we studied about in class, and the third one is right up here underneath the A horizons, and this has a value of 4, chroma of 1, where I saw it, and it has at least 2% redox concentrations in it that are distinct. They're not cemented. It doesn't matter if they're pore linings. It doesn't matter if they're masses. It doesn't matter if they're inside root channels. As long as they're not cemented and they add up to 2% and they're distinct, then you have a depleted, a depleted matrix. And that means it's depleted of oxidized iron. That's all it means. Okay, so you've actually now know just at this site what all three of the matrices should look like. If it stays on the glade page, value 4 or more, glade matrix. If it changes color upon exposure to oxygen, it doesn't matter what page it starts on, it's a reduced matrix. And if it doesn't change color, you don't expect it to change color if it's above the water table, but if it's value 4 or more, chroma 2 or less, 2% or more distinct concentrations, it's a depleted matrix.
Around
here, you have a finer textured surface and a sandy layer under it, okay, and you see it here. Part of what that does is, again, because you have a finer textured surface, that amplifies what we call in terms of the mineral flat or the Picosin effect. Because these surfaces are so flat and so linear, once they wet up, they don't drain out very well at all. It literally takes until you pump enough water out of the soil by midsummer and physically lower the water table regionally. There's also a diagram in the handout that shows a groundwater mound here. Across this entire surface, there's between 5 to 6 feet of annual groundwater flux.
Right there.
Horizon. Yeah, man, this is all part. Take some pictures. Everybody asks me what I do. I'm like, just look at dirt.
Kind of stuff. It came from a foreign side, a landfill. It's the top of the Yorktown, which is the Pliocene layer that's under everything here. It's full of shells, typically pH 7, 5, and 8. The first time bit was put in, which would have been about 2008 and 2009, they didn't do anything to it. They planted it and everything died. They then came back in again and had an enormous pile of wood bark waste here, out here. Brought that in a layer, worked it in, and in the soil you'll see these little sort of dark sort of patches of organic matter. That's what's left of the pieces of the wood bark in here. They also came through, believe it or not, they did run a chisel plow through here, supposedly. I think when they did it, it was probably too wet. And there was an effort made here to loosen the soil down to about a foot. So it's actually not quite as tight as it used to be. But at depth, if you attempt under down at depth, the bulk density down there is about 1.75, 1.8. It's extremely dense.
Dude, you know what I just realized?
What?
I'm going to do a blog entry about this field trip and have awesome pictures.
Yeah, it's going to be awesome. So right now we're looking at another natural soil.
Lots of roots.
Man, this is soft. It's real warm.
It is. This is a crazy texture. That's a loam. Definitely.
Oh, that's nice.
It's like fluffy.
It's like the perfect texture. Yeah.
This is like gardening soil.
Yeah. Probably a silt loam. Really? It's definitely dominated by silt size. It feels like flowery.
Yeah, you can feel it. Yeah,
flowery.
Flowery. not a description I would have used for soil, but it kind of fits the description. Kind of think about it.